Monday through Friday, 8 to 5, Saturday, 8 till noon. More information at 800-LG-TIRES, 800-LG-TIRES.
It's graduation time in the Catskills.
This year, the pandemic prevented local seniors from enjoying proms, award dinners, and other traditional events.
Many folks have come up with creative alternatives to honor and celebrate the grads, including us here at WIOX.
Hi, I'm John Bernhard, host of Tip Off.
I'm Joy St. George, host of Music Matters.
And I'm Arnie Schwartz, host of Talk of the Town. And the three of us would like to invite you to tune into a very special radio event.
The Congratulations to Graduate Show, hosted by Joyce, Arnie, and me, this Friday from 9 a.m. to noon.
We'll be celebrating 2020 graduates, focusing on seniors from Margaretville, Andes, and Roxbury Central Schools.
We'll share the graduates' school and community accomplishments, their plans for the future, and memories of their school experience.
So join us this Friday morning at 9 for Congratulations to Graduates.
Right here on WIOX Roxbury.
Okay, you are listening to WIOX Community Radio, live and local in the Catskill Mountains at 91.3 FM and MTC Cable Channel 20, and everywhere at WIOXradio.org, where it's easy to donate if you like what you hear. You can also get WIOX on any smart device through the Radio FM app. This is From the Forest, every Wednesday, 6 to 7 p.m., talk about a different forest-related topic with Ryan and John. John, how's it going?
Things are good today, but it has been hot.
It has been hot, and it's dry. We got a little rain last night, I guess.
Yeah, I don't know. We're in Delhi area. Maybe it was up to an inch. I had a bucket out outside, not to capture the rain, but just because it was out. And they had about an inch of water in it this morning.
Yeah, nice.
So good, but the rivers didn't look like it changed.
No,
so that's dry.
Yeah, that water soaked right in. Yeah, we could use some water. The Benekil over here in village of Margaville is dry, you know. We could use some. Trees are not wilting yet, but I remember a few years ago, it could have been 5 years ago or more, we had a really dry summer in the dogwoods down in the town of Gardner in Ulster County started to wilt, but we're not there yet. But if it continues, we shall see.
I don't know. I planted fruit trees this year in the spring, and now I have to water them constantly.
Yeah. Well, one good thing for this year I've noticed is the mulberries, man. If you're down in Kingston or Oneonta, I don't know if Oneonta has about mulberries, but Kingston is loaded. The whole Rondout Valley corridor and Sopus, There's a lot of mulberries out there right now, so cool. good eating.
Are they ripening?
Hell yeah.
Okay, I don't know when they ripen.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, one of my favorite trees. Disease resistant. The birds love them. You know, they'll squawk at you when you're trying to pick them. They get pissed off, but that's okay.
You can fight them off, right?
Yeah, that's
right. You can win?
Yeah, no, I usually win. They fly away. But, you know, so there's all sorts of mulberries out there. And if you're getting your car fixed or you're going to Tractor Supply or whatever, you can usually find a mulberry somewhere in between there. So you usually can see staining on the road and look up, there's a mulberry.
Okay, well, I have to go down to Kingston on Monday for a truck appointment. So
yeah, look around, man.
I'll go for a walk.
You know, the IBM, where it used to be IBM, those are good places to find mulberries because it grows in the crack of an old parking lot, gets a foothold, and bam, mulberry. So,
okay, there we go.
Yeah, it's all over. But speaking of streams being low, it's not so good probably for the brook trout because, you know, you need some water and cold water and whatnot. But hopefully they do well. I have not fished at all really this year because I like to wait for the water to come up a little bit where I live. How about you?
I've only been out once, caught one brown trout, and then two chubs.
Two chubs?
Yeah.
No kidding. Huh. Well, it's better than I've done. I haven't caught anything. So, but tonight's show is Catskill Heritage Brook Trout Study with SUNY Albany's Dr. Spencer Bruce. He has a PhD postdoctoral research associate from SUNY Albany, noted for his work in analyzing the genetics of New York State brook trout. And let me see if I can get him on the phone. Spencer, are you there?
I'm here.
All right.
Thanks for having me.
Hey, thanks for coming on.
Anytime.
What's the weather like up there in Albany, I assume you are? I don't know.
Well, I do. Yeah, I live in the Albany area, but I'm actually in the Adirondacks right now, and it's pretty nice up here. Cool, not too hot, and breezy, so it's not bad. But as you mentioned down there, you know, it's been pretty dry, so a lot of low water around here.
Yeah, absolutely. And so I was researching you online, and you also are working on anthrax and wildlife. What's that about?
Yeah, so right now I work in a disease ecology lab, and we're looking at anthrax transmission in wildlife in Africa. So I had the opportunity to go to Africa and help with some sampling there, and I'm working on the genetics of the different strains of anthrax that infect wildlife. People usually think of anthrax as something that you get in the mail from a terrorist, but it actually more commonly affects wildlife and livestock. And, you know, if you raise livestock here in the United States, you give your livestock a vaccine so they don't pick up anthrax.
No kidding. John, you ever heard of that?
So, that's a bacteria?
Yeah, it's a bacterium, and it's pretty common. It's all over the world, and it's been around for a while. You can even find hieroglyphs in Egypt that depict animals with anthrax, so it's been a problem. And actually, the first vaccine ever developed was developed for anthrax.
Wow.
Yeah, I've gotten that vaccine. I don't know how long it lasts, but...
Yeah,
that was fun. So what got you into wildlife biology anyway?
I used to live... it's kind of a long story, but I'll tell it. I originally went to school for art history, and I ended up living down in the city. And I had a job down there that I wasn't crazy about, and I kind of felt like, oh, man, I want to get out of this city. And I knew I wanted to do something that put me outside. And I wasn't sure exactly what, but I actually went back to school at Brooklyn College for biology, and I just got interested in fish. So I started reading about fish, and that's when I learned about these heritage brook trout or these native strains of brook trout in New York State that, were thought to be pretty elusive. And, I kind of followed that, and that's kind of taken me to where I am now. So, I went to get a master's degree, and then I did my PhD at the University at Albany, and I did it in conjunction with the New York State Museum and the ichthyology department there, where they study fish. So that kind of brought me to the brook trout, and you know, most of my work that I've done over the past 8 or so years has really been focused on brook trout genetics, not anthrax, actually. So I've really been working on it for quite a while now, and you know, it's exciting. I you know, I'm passionate about it. It's exciting, and I love to talk about it.
Is that what you're doing in the Adirondacks right now?
No, I'm just relaxing right now, to be honest.
There's several strains of native trout in streams of the Adirondacks, right?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah, so, you know, if you look at a map of brook trout health in New York State, the strongholds are the Catskills and the Adirondacks, because that's where you have mountains, that's where you have nice freshwater springs, and that's where you have clean, cold, clear water. You know, that's where you find brook trout.
So what can you tell us about this brook trout before we get into it? You know, any biology or cool things about it? Has it been around since the glaciers? When did it arrive? You know any of that stuff? What do you think?
Yeah. I mean, the brook trout is one of two species of trout that are native to the northeastern United States. The other is the lake trout. But the lake trout is only found in deep, very cold lakes, and they usually in the summer months are hanging around at the bottom to stay cool. Brook trout, on the other hand, are found in, you know, they're also found in lakes and ponds, but they're found in streams and tributaries and riverine ecosystems as well, and also brooks, and that's why they're called brook trout. So the other two trout that people are used to catching in New York State are brown trout and rainbow trout. So brown trout are actually native to Europe. They were brought over here by European settlers. And then the rainbow trout is actually native to the west coast of North America. So those have been transported here from the west coast. So those two species actually, you know, weren't here 10,000 years ago. But 10,000 years ago, as the glaciers receded, brook trout populated all of the drainage basins, and they were really a very important fish to Native Americans and then to European settlers. And then they've slowly been replaced by fish like perch and black bass and lakes and ponds, but they're still pretty prevalent throughout the Northeast.
So do these brook trout have pressures from brown trout that they have problems with?
Well, that's a good question. You know, it's hard to say, but if you have brown trout and brook trout in the same watershed, if they're not interacting with each other, they're definitely at least competing for resources. You know, whether they're negatively affecting the brook trout population or not is hard to say, but any way you look at it, they're certainly you know, taking up resources that would otherwise go to the fish that were there before they were put there by the state.
It just seems anecdotally, just fishing the Catskill streams, you lose brown trout as you move upwards on the tributaries. As the stream gets smaller, you have less and less likely to find a brown trout.
Oh, that's definitely true. I would say if you put brown trout and brook trout head-to-head in a smaller headwater stream, that the brook trout would win. But there, you know, I've definitely sampled in areas where you find fingerlings, you know, young of the year of both brown and brook trout in the same habitat, that's somewhere in between, up high in the stream and some and lower down. So they definitely do share some habitat, and so there's always going to be some sort of competition there. But you know, with brown trout, you know, brown trout are obviously a very popular sport fish with anglers, and you know, a lot of that stocking that happens, that the state does, you know, their mission is really to not just conserve fisheries but to enhance them. And you know, fly fishing, of course, is a huge industry in the Catskill region and the Adirondacks, so brown trout have really been stocked for quite some time.
Yeah, I mean, brook trout's pretty much the only fish I go after, and I find anecdotally, of course, John, that once you get above 1,000, 1,200 feet, you know, better chance of brook trout. But below that, almost never. Brook trout,
yeah.
I find.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, it depends. You know, I think it depends where you are. I think certain areas where there hasn't been habitat destruction, there hasn't been the introduction of other fish, you can find them at lower altitudes, given that the water quality is right and it's cold enough and things like that. So I think that one of the reasons you see brook trout at such high altitudes up in these headwater streams is because, you know, over the past century, a lot of their habitat has been either degraded, polluted, or they've been replaced by other fish that weren't there before. And they've been in a state of decline for quite a while, but at the same time, they're a really hardy fish and can hold their own in the environment they're really accustomed to, which is small brooks and streams. So, they're not going anywhere either.
Right.
At least for the time being.
Yeah, that's what it seems like to me. It's a New York State fish. A lot of people don't realize that. And West Virginia, I know their state fish is the brook trout as well.
Yeah, there's a couple other states, too. I can't remember what they all are, but there's quite a few on the East Coast where their state fish is the brook trout. And it's a beautiful fish. I mean, it's got, you know, those beautiful little halos. There's nothing else that looks quite like it.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask you next before we get into the meat of the show. Like, well, what do you think makes this fish so special? I mean, it's special to me, but what do you think it's so special for?
Well, one thing is it's an indicator of really, really pristine water quality. So if you find a brook trout in a watershed, you know that watershed has nice, clean, clear water. The other thing is it is, it's a native fish to the northeastern United States. You know, people love to fish here. People go fishing for salmon. They go fishing for, as I mentioned before, brown trout, rainbow trout. They love to fish for bass, for perch. But really, the brook trout was the big catch if you just go back 100 years or so. That's what people were interested in fishing for, and it really was a staple for Native Americans. They used it not just to eat, but they also used it to fertilize their crops. And, it was here, you know, as someone who was born and raised in the northeastern United States and in New York State, it's part of our heritage. It's part of, what makes New York, New York.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a lot of brook trout out there, and sometimes you'd be surprised. Well, you wouldn't maybe, Spencer, but some of these small streams where they exist, and sometimes you catch one, it freaks you out how big it is on how small of a stream. Right, John? Is that a rock?
Biggest brook trout I ever caught was on the smallest stream I ever attempted to fish.
Yeah. I remember I put my spinner. Don't kill me now. I'm not a fly fisherman, so just hold on. I put the spinner in a bucket-sized plunge pool, you know, just frothy.
Yeah.
It happened to go in there. It caught a brook trout. I pulled it out. It was like a 10-inch brook trout, and I couldn't believe it.
Awesome.
You know? You never know where those little guys are.
Yeah, they're beautiful, and, they're everywhere. On some of my sampling campaigns, we've caught brook trout in streams that aren't more than 2.5 feet wide. I mean, they really get up in there, and that's where they do well.
Is there an upper limit, like elevation wise, that you haven't found them in?
No, I don't think so. Not in New York State, anyways. I mean, there's the at top of Mount Marcy. There's, I think it's called Lake Tear in the Clouds, and that's full of brook trout. So they're up there. I mean, that's their preferred habitat, and those are also the places that are least affected by human beings. So, they persevere in those environments.
Yeah, I would just say anecdotally again, like 25 to 2,700 feet, just run out of water.
Right.
Because it's not enough to feed it in the Catskills from above.
Yep.
I would agree. I don't know. So, if you're just tuning in, tonight's topic is Catskill Heritage Brook Trout Study with SUNY Albany's Dr. Spencer Bruce. And the reason why we got Spencer Bruce on the phone tonight is the Ashokan-Pepacton Watershed, APW, that's a chapter of Trout Unlimited, received a grant, I believe, from the Ashokan Watershed Stream Management Program, which is in Shokan, Ulster County. And they also received a license from the New York State DEC to collect or possess, because you can't just go out there and possess these things. You got to get a license. And they were doing studies on some genetics in one particular stream in the Catskill Mountains. So, yeah, can you tell us about that, Spencer?
Sure. So, you know, this was a project that was really, you know, I've been working on identifying different strains of brook trout for some time, but this was a project that was really headed up by a fellow named Ed, and I'm not even going to attempt to pronounce his last name. I don't want to do him that disjustice, but he, you know, he is one of the top guys at this chapter of Trout Unlimited, and he contacted me and said, you know, they, you know, I went down there and did a talk for them on my brook trout work, and they were interested in doing this study and maybe finding out the genetic origins of some of the strains down there. So he got in touch with me and pitched this idea. And, you know, I love this idea because it's great. You know, a lot of the work I have done is, you know, where I'm going out with other scientists and we're doing sampling in the wild. But, you know, what was great about this particular project with Trout Unlimited was these guys were going to go out and catch these fish themselves for these genetic samples. So it was really kind of like a citizen science effort, which is great because the best thing you could do if you're interested in the sort of science that I do is get people involved in it. That's how you really get the message out there. So it was really Ed's idea to do this citizen science sampling and then have me do the genetic work. So, you know, over the course of that summer, those guys went out and they caught, you know, roughly, I can't remember the exact number, maybe 30 fish. So usually when we analyze brook trout, we want to do it at the population level. So to get a good sample, we really need about 30 fish. And, you know, we never kill the fish. It's usually, you know, when I do sampling with other scientists, we usually use electrofishing where we send a small charge through the water and then temporarily stuns the fish and you can scoop them up. But in this case, obviously, we're using traditional angling. So they would catch a trout and then they take a tiny, tiny tissue sample, really about the size of you know, a fingernail clipping off of the tail fin that grows right back, and then they release the trout back. So that's how we did the sampling for the project. And then I did the genetic work, and I compare the genetics to different brook trout from the region, as well as the six different strains that the state usually stocks in New York State based on different circumstances. And what we found in terms of this particular study was that, the brook trout looked pretty pristine. We didn't really see any signs of influence from stocked fish. And then when we put them into our biogeographic framework with other strains from that region, which we knew were native or heritage strains, their genetics was consistent. So it's usually this two-step approach we use to determine the origins of the brook trout, and it seemed to be, you know, a pretty pure, pristine population with little to no influence from stocked fish at all.
And this, let's just back up for a second. This is in South Hollow Brook, which is in West Shokan, right, Ulster County?
I can't tell you for sure, I mean, because I didn't do the sampling. So I've definitely done quite a bit of sampling down in the Catskills, but for this particular project, it was really this Trout Unlimited chapter that went in and did the sampling.
And how come you want to do it by traditional angling methods instead of electroshock and just get people involved or otherwise?
Yeah, I mean, it's great because you get people involved. They get interested in the project. You know, I'm talking about the work I did with Trout Unlimited. I also do a lot of work with an organization called Trout Power up here in the Adirondacks, and they do a lot of the same things where they're doing citizen science things where they're bringing in student groups or veteran groups to do this citizen science where we're collecting specimens or tissue samples and then we're analyzing them. So, you know, it's a great way to get the word out about the science and really get people involved who otherwise would, you know, kind of maybe not be so interested or not really be on board with, you know, what the type of science or the type of things we're trying to do. And I think with brook trout, it's important to understand that, you know, native fish that aren't from a hatchery have been in these watersheds for 10,000 years. So they likely have unique adaptations to these watersheds where you find them that you could never find in a hatchery fish that is propagated in an unnatural environment. So identifying these populations and protecting them is important, really, for the future of brook trout because, you know, they represent these unique populations that are well-suited to the areas where they are found. And, you know, they're here. They still persist after 100 years. So they're a tough fish.
I mean, I'm kind of surprised because I live near South Hollow Brook. And I've fished on some pretty remote brook trout streams. This is pretty accessible, at least from my perspective. You know, you go up the Bushkill on Peekamoose Road, and there it is. And it's had a strong land use history of land clearing for farming, really up to its source just about. It's the old Freeman Avery Road that goes up and over to Sampsonville where I live. And, you know, tanning was before that, but then land clearing, pretty much the whole tributary. People fish it nonstop. I mean, everyone, their brother, locals, fish South Hollow Brook. I'm surprised. It's like, it's this pristine. I really am, to be honest. If it's pristine on South Hollow Brook, I don't know. I'm hopeful.
Right. So, I mean, that's a good point. And my work has not been specific to only a handful of streams. We've really surveyed the entire state of New York. We've looked at over 100 different streams and river populations, as well as lake and pond populations. And really what we've found is that in these river and headwater stream populations, the stocked fish don't really have much of an influence. They may be stocked there, but something is going on where they're not hybridizing with the wild fish that are there. Now, that situation is not always the same. It depends where you are. So, for example, up here in the Adirondacks, there is a hybrid strain that's stocked all the time. And this strain seems to do a little better in acidic water, so we see a little more of mixing with that strain. And then if we look at lakes and ponds, which are more still, we see a much higher influence from the stock trout in those scenarios. So there's something about brook trout that are wild and wild reproducing in rivers and streams where they really seem to hold some sort of advantage over stock trout, where the stock trout aren't able to mix with them much, and we don't really see any ancestry from them in that environment.
So are those stocked fish, do you think they're breeding and successfully at high rates, or just that's not happening?
It depends where you are. So in some instances, yes. But for the most part, what we've seen, so we sampled, so just thinking about work that's completed at this point, maybe we've done 80 or so stream or river reaches, and we found that in maybe half of those, we were able to detect some influence from stocked fish, but it was relatively low, maybe something like 20 to 25% of the ancestry was attributed to stocked fish, where this other 75% or so was attributed to a native strain. But then in the other half, the other 40 or so streams we sampled, we didn't really find any evidence of mixing from stocked fish at all. Most of the places we sampled in the Catskills, we didn't really see much influence from stocked fish at all. Really, a lot of the influence was up here in the Adirondacks, and part of that may be because there's a lot more stocking that goes on up here every year as well. So, before we started this work, it was kind of assumed that everything had been swamped out by stocked fish since it's been going on for a century or two centuries. But a lot of this work has kind of turned that on its head and says, you know, these wild native fish that are here, they've got some home team advantage that these stocked fish don't, and they have been using it. And that's pretty exciting from a conservation standpoint.
We're going to take a break, but if you're just tuning in, you're listening to From the Forest every Wednesday, 6 to 7 p.m. Tonight's topic is Catskill Heritage Brook Trout Study with SUNY Albany's Spencer Bruce. Up next, I'm going to ask some specific questions on how they broke down the genetics of these fish.
In twilight glow I see blue eyes. was crying in the rain. When we kissed goodbye and parted, I knew we'd never meet again. Love is like a dying ember, and only memories remain. Through the ages, I'll remember blue eyes crying in the rain.
Got blue eyes, you probably aren't crying in the rain, because there's not much of it these days, right, John?
No, I haven't seen any.
If you're just tuning in, this is From the Forest every Wednesday, 6 to 7 p.m., and tonight's topic is Catskill Heritage Brook Trout Study with SUNY Albany's Dr. Spencer Bruce. Last year, the Ashokan-Pepacton Watershed chapter of Trout Unlimited teamed up with Spencer Bruce from SUNY Albany and did a trout analysis on their genetics to see if how special they might be, you know, how native they might be. And I guess 32 brook trout were taken, fin clippings were removed. Then what? You store them in alcohol, and it says here, Spencer, that you do a DNA extraction and genotyping at 12 microsatellite loci. What does that mean?
So that's what we do. So, you know, as I mentioned before, we get these tissue samples from the fish without harming the fish. We put them in ethanol to preserve them, and we bring them back to the lab. So once we get them in the lab, the first thing we have to do is extract the DNA from those tissues, and that involves breaking the tissues down and then going through this process of basically running them through these magnetized beads until we get to a point where we have a solution that just has DNA. So to compare the DNA, you know, when you do a DNA extraction from an animal, what you end up with is not one big strand of DNA. You end up with tiny fragments of chopped up DNA. So what we do with brook trout is we specifically look at different sections of DNA, and we're interested in these microsatellites. So a microsatellite is just a repeat unit of DNA. So DNA is made up of four bases, which are often referred to as G, C, A, and T. That's basically the genetic code. So a microsatellite is a repeat that's just like, say, G, C, G, C, G, C, G, C. So in some fish, that G, C repeat might be 26 letters long, and in other fish, it might be 28 letters long. So we basically use these patterns, these patterns of genetic code at these 13 different microsatellite positions in the DNA to look at how these fish are either related or how they're not related, or if they're hybrids and what proportion can be attributed to what strain. So if you get 30 or so fish, then you have you do this analysis and you get a pretty good idea of, okay, these are the the repeat numbers at each of these 13 different positions that we see that's specific to this population, and that's what helps us do our analysis. Does that make sense?
John?
It does to me. I've taken two genetics courses in college, so it's all coming back fine for me. But how about you, Ryan?
Well, okay, so for us people out there who are not geneticists, okay, and correct me when I stray. So you're comparing it to known native strains throughout the state and the Catskills first and the Stockies. Is that right? Okay, and then what did you find from that? Let's go. I know you kind of talked about this already, but people are just tuning in or don't understand.
Yeah, I hear you. So, you know, first you compare it to the stock strains, right? So if there has been influence from stock strains in these brook trout, you're going to see some of the same patterns of repeats in the stock trout, that you're going to see in the trout you took from whatever watershed. So first we do that analysis. And once we see that, you know, there's either we can say, at that point we can say, well, look, this looks like, you know, we can attribute 50% of this fish's ancestry to, you know, one of the strains stocked by the state. If we can, if we say all of these microsatellite patterns look unique, they don't match with the state, that's when we compare them to the other native strains. So so it's a two-step process. First, we just see if they have been influenced by fish that we know are stocked and have been stocked since, you know, the 1980s. And then once we rule that out, the second step is to compare them to other fish that also don't seem to have any influence from these stocked fish. So to do that, we kind of do it from a biogeographic standpoint, right, which says that fish that are found in the same regions, right, like native brook trout from the Catskills should be more similar to each other than native brook trout, than comparing a native brook trout from the Catskills to one from the Adirondack. So it's this whole concept that, you know, we should see this genetic pattern that is consistent with watersheds and proximity to each other at different locations. So the first step is check for influence from currently stocked strains, and the second part is to put them in this biogeographic framework to see if they fit these patterns we would expect based on what we know about how these fish colonized New York State based on drainage basins.
Okay, and what did you conclude?
So for this specific study, I mean, they fit right in. They didn't show any influence from stock strains, and they were very similar to not only the known heritage strains that have been documented in the region, but to the other native strains we also have sampled from the Catskill region as well. You know, they looked like to be a very pure native strain of brook trout there in that watershed. And, you know, I think that Trout Unlimited is planning on doing another one. I think they were going to do it this summer, but with everything going on with COVID, I don't know if they're still going to do it, but they're doing one in Ox Clove as well, which I'm not personally familiar with. But, you know, this has been an ongoing relationship with Trout Unlimited, and we're continuing to work together.
Now, is this strain even more exclusive from other known heritage Catskill strains?
I wouldn't say that. It's not far out there. One thing we find is that, you know, if you look at a specific watershed or a specific region, populations that are very close together geographically, you can certainly differentiate them from each other. But when compared to other regions, they're very closely related. So, you know, we know that at some point when the glaciers receded, we had a Hudson River that was much bigger, you can almost think of it like a sloshing bowl across back and forth across the state. And at that point is really when all of our brook trout colonized the different watersheds where they're found. So, you know, over time, you have a population in one stream that has kind of stuck there and continues to reproduce, whereas over time, you know, if you go, you know, a couple river systems over, you'll have another population. And usually they're pretty closely related, and we can really see these patterns actually like reflect a map. If you plot these patterns out, and you look at them, you can see that, you know, it reflects the watershed map of New York State, because these patterns of genetics are really based on these waterway paths where they use to colonize the state.
Are there any slight differentiations between the two major watersheds in the Catskills? The Catskill Divide, on one side is the Delaware watershed, right, and the other is the Hudson. Are you seeing any differentiation between those two watersheds?
Yeah, sure. You can, fish that we've typed from the Delaware and ones that drain into the Hudson, you can definitely see a difference in that. You know, the ones from the Hudson are more closely related to each other, but they're still pretty closely related compared to, say, an Adirondack brook trout. A brook trout from the Delaware and a brook trout from that drains into the lower Hudson and the Catskills definitely have more in common with each other than they do with a brook trout from the Adirondacks or from the Allegheny drainage basin or from other areas. So they're different, but not as different as, fish from other regions, I guess.
John?
So after this study you did there, what further research are you looking to do in the next study then?
Well, we've done quite a few studies now. So really, most of the work I'm doing now is we have this new study in Ox Clove that I'm doing with Trout Unlimited down there. And then I'm doing actually a long-term study up here in the Adirondacks where we're going to be sampling the same watershed over and over every year to see how the genetics change over time, and if they change at all, and to see what that looks like. So a lot of the work we've done up to this point is really just kind of looking at the origin of these different strains, but now we're kind of moving into a territory where we're also looking at adaptation, like what makes the genetics of these strains different, and what are some of these unique adaptations that these strains have in terms of the watersheds where they're found. We're starting to work on some of these newer projects, and we're going in that direction, which hopefully will create some interesting results, especially given that now warming waters are a big threat to brook trout. If we can find out more about what genes regulate their heat regulation, then we can potentially, fine-tune our efforts to protect them based on what we know about that.
Well, I got you on this phone. I got a question for you. All right, so yeah. I used to read a lot about brook trout, and there's an excellent book called Brook Trout. I think his name is Nick Karras that wrote the book.
Yeah, I read that one.
Yeah, it's a great book. And, you know, it's like these guys used to, back in the day, in the late 19th century or mid-19th century or so, they wouldn't even record, according to Nick, the inches. Like, was it an 8-inch trout or a 10-inch trout? They would record numbers of trout. Right, that they would get, because that's how many brook trout there were. And then at some point it became brown trout, right? But this is like peak land clearing. I mean, we have the most reduced forest cover in New York State's history and in the Catskills during this time period. Now we have the opposite. We have the most forest cover than we had in the last 100 years. I just don't get it. Is there something else going on with why aren't there more brook trout than there should be? Or even brown trout, for that matter.
Right. That's a good question. I mean, I think there's so many factors at play. You know, one of the big things, there are a number of big things that have decimated brook trout populations. I think that, you know, road building and damming definitely kind of messed up habitat for maybe bigger brook trout that were more riverine, that were moving back and forth. And then you also had, when logging started, you had this, you know, just logging happening everywhere where logs are being dumped into rivers, and then all this damming was going on, so logging has played a big role. And then the other really big thing, and I'm not completely certain about how this has affected the Catskills, but in the Adirondacks, acid rain has been devastating for brook trout. I mean, there have been hundreds and hundreds of populations in headwater streams and ponds that have been lost to acid rain, really in the 1960s and 70s and into the 80s. And what we have happening, anyways, in the Adirondacks is that the water chemistry is getting better and they're coming back. But the other thing is, you know, brook trout were found in lakes and ponds before bass and perch were introduced to a lot of these places. So, And that's big-time competition. Those bass can really tolerate those warmer temperatures, and they will just replace brook trout if they're long enough. So, you know, it's a replacement by other species that weren't there before. It has to do with, you know, all types of landscape features. It has to do with acid rain. And, you know, now the big thing is the water's getting warmer, too. So, you know, as things continue to change, I think that the big guys were kind of sitting pretty. You know, they were the fat cats. They got to just sit around and pick up what was ever going down. But, you know, when the bass and the perch came in, they really replaced them in the lakes and ponds. And it's really the lakes and ponds that have those deep, deep, cold holes where the brook trout can hang out and get really big, like lake trout. And if those bass and perch are there, it's just not going to happen.
I mean, the Catskills, we don't really have as many ponds and lakes as the Adirondacks. It's really the land of little streams. But what about predators? I mean, to me, that's, as a, you know, looking at the forest and wildlife comebacks, we have predators that weren't here in the last 100 years. And to me, that's one of the biggest differences that have negatively affected. Acid rain has been around, but, you know, Frost Valley has documented that acid rain has improved. But, you know, we got bald eagles, we have mergansers. We have blue herons that are all protected, and I see these guys fishing way more than I do.
Yeah.
I mean, it's got to have something, and maybe not. I don't really know. I'm just posing the question.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good that's a good point. I remember even when I was going to get you know, reference samples from the hatchery, they were having problems because they had these like osprey or something that were hanging around and just picking out fish. So. I mean, a lot of different animals eat fish as well. So they're definitely making a dent in some places. But, you know, brook trout are pretty hard to catch. And, you know, I think really that with brook trout, you know, I think a major lack of brook trout that we see now is really due to bass and perch. I mean, even in the larger river systems, they've replaced them. And, you know, and I think, you know, if you take a population out of an area where there's good spawning habitat and another population's not able to come in because bass and perch are around, they just don't come back. So, you know, that's a big thing. I think that there were a couple documented heritage strains back in the 80s in the Catskill region. One was the Tunis Lake strain, I believe. The other was the Balsam Lake strain. I think the Tunis Lake strain, you know, there, I think during I can't remember which hurricane, maybe Sandy, a dam broke from up above and a bunch of bass got into that lake and boom, they're gone now. So, so really, I think bass are probably the biggest culprit in removing the big brook trout that people remember from, you know, 100 years ago or so.
So what's the answer? Are we going to just put Rotenone in all the lakes and convert them back over?
No, I mean, been done. You know, I just, we can't. Well, we obviously can't go back in time. I mean, I think the answer is, you know, after working on this for many years, I think for me, the answer is to leave it alone. A lot of stocking goes on, and I'm not convinced that, you know, that might be great for people who want to go and catch a big government fish, but I'm not convinced that in many cases those fish are interbreeding, and if they are interbreeding, I don't think they're having a positive effect. And if they're not interbreeding, they are competing with the native brook trout for food. So I think the real lesson is here is, you know, if you have a nice brook trout population, whether it's in a river, a stream, or a lake, or a pond, the best thing you can really do is leave it alone.
I feel like stocking, again, I didn't go to school for fisheries or anything, but I feel like stocking, like, max, it serves as a distraction of what's going wrong, maybe. Because if you're seeing fish and you're catching them, but those are stocked fish, maybe you don't realize that the habitat is worse than it really is. I mean, I don't know.
Right. I mean, if you want to talk about stocking, there's a lot of reasons you can be against stocking. First of all, you know, you have to raise these fish in a hatchery. A hatchery consumes major resources in terms of energy to run. You also have these populations of fish that are becoming inbred during this process. You're essentially reducing the fish's fitness. And then you have to feed those fish. Usually those fish are fed with ocean pellets that are unsustainably harvest from the ocean, from other fish in the ocean. And then on top of that, they create a lot of waste that's dumped into usually the nearest watershed. So then you take those fish and you put them out for people to catch, and maybe some people do catch them, but if they don't catch them, what happens to those fish? Either they're reproducing with the wild fish, which may or may not have negative effects, or they're not reproducing with the wild fish, and they are just competing with them for resources. On top of that, you have a scenario where these fish from the hatchery, if they pick up something like a parasite or disease, and then you go and stock them all over, I mean, that could be devastating for brook trout populations, you know, or any fishery population all over the state. So that's something to worry about, too. And, you know, fish, you know, you can compare them to corn as well. You know, if we have the same stocked fish in every watershed and a parasite or disease comes through, it could wipe them all out. But if we have these different little pockets of unique fish, then maybe it'll affect one or two populations and not the other. So, you know, there's a lot to think about there.
If you're just tuning in, you're listening to From the Forest. Tonight's topic is Catskill Heritage Brook Trout Study with SUNY Albany's Dr. Spencer Bruce. We only have about 6 minutes left in the show. What surprised you the most about doing these studies?
Oh, I think about it was certainly just the number of, when I started to study these, all these different studies, the expectation was, you know, maybe we find half a dozen or a dozen populations that have not been influenced by stocked fish. And really what we ended up finding was many, many more than that. So what was so surprising was just the resiliency of these native fish, that they have really held on to these river and stream habitats for the past 100 years. And despite, you know, repeated stocking over the course of a century, they have maintained their stronghold and they're still here. So, you know, I got into this because I was interested in brook trout conservation, and it was really astounding to see, you know, just these fish persevere over this long period of time.
John, you have anything to add? A few more minutes left here.
Well, I think that's pretty neat. You're finding so many, especially in the Catskill region. Is there any management or policy issues that you see as major hurdles to keeping that kind of the way it is, other than the stocking we've talked about? Is there any other management techniques that can be applied?
Well, you know, I've worked very closely on this with the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. And, you know, when I talk about stocking, I don't mean to bash them at all. They have been a great partner in this, and they were just as interested as I was. So they've really kind of changed the way they manage trout streams based on a lot of this work. And, you know, they are really trying to stick to stocking in areas where they don't believe there are natural reproducing populations. You know, they also have a program up here in the Adirondacks where they're stocking these native strains in areas where brook trout have been previously extirpated or have gone locally extinct. So the state is actually doing quite a bit based on this research. And, you know, I think, you know, there is some value to stocking in that, you know, if a little kid can go out and easily catch, you know, a big fat brook trout and get excited about fishing, that's great. You know, if you can stock brook trout in a pond or a lake that where brook trout have gone locally extinct and bring a population back where there wasn't one before, that's great. So, you know, I don't want to completely throw stocking out the window, but I think that, you know, there's many different layers to the problems, and depending on how you think about it, there's a lot that can be done. At this moment, it seems like the state is really taking the right approach where they're backing off stocking on top of native populations or wild populations, and they're really focusing more on a put-and-take fishery where the fish go into a place where they might not be other brook trout, where people can fish for them, and then they don't survive over the winter, and so it has less of an impact on the other native trout species.
And what are you working on next?
Well, that's a great question. Right now, you know, I mentioned this long-term study I'm doing in the Sagamore watershed, but I'm also working on sequencing the brook trout genome. So I am working with this organization, Trout Power up here in the Adirondacks, and we are going to do the first full sequence of the brook trout genome. And this will be a great resource for other geneticists and researchers working on the brook trout to essentially map to this genome so we can find out more, just not about just their biogeography and how they're mixing with each other, but also about, you know, how their genes affect the different ways these populations are able to survive throughout their entire native range. So that's the big project in the future, and I'm pretty excited about it.
Yeah. And that's about all the time we have on From the Forest. And, Spencer, thank you so much for coming on tonight.
Well, anytime. I had a great time. Thanks for having me.
All right. Good luck in studying the brook trout. And if you missed the show, that was Dr. Spencer Bruce from SUNY Albany talking about the Catskill Heritage Brook Trout Study conducted in South Hollow Brook in the town of Olive, Ulster County. John, anything?
It's pretty cool. I mean, he said it all. I mean, it's neat that there are not interbreeding, and they're their own unique strain.
Yeah, absolutely, man. All right, well, that's all the time we have tonight, and next week, I don't know what we're doing.
Okay.
I guess we'll feel it out.
Sounds good. Know? We missed last week. Gary Mead was going to be on and then changed plans, but that's all right. He'll be back on next month.
Yeah, Mr. Mead every third Wednesday. But that's all I have tonight, and see you next Wednesday.
Good night, everyone.
Oh, the neon lights were flashing and the icy wind did blow. The water seeped into his shoes and the drizzle turned to snow. His eyes were red, his hopes were dead, and the wine was running low. And the old man came home from the forest. His tears fell on the sidewalk as he stumbled in the street. A dozen faces stopped to stare, but no one stopped to speak. For his castle was a hallway, and the bottle was his friend. And the old man stumbled in from the forest. Up a dark and dingy staircase, the old man made his way. His ragged coat around him as upon his cot he lay. And he wondered how it happened that he'd ended up this way. Getting lost like a fool in the forest. And as he lay there sleeping, did appear. Upon his mantle shining the face of one so dear, who'd loved him in the springtime of a long forgotten year, when the wildflowers did bloom in the forest. She touched his grizzled fingers and she called him by his name. And then he heard the joyful sound of children at their games. In an old house on a hillside in some forgotten town, where the river runs down from the forest. With a mighty roar, big jet soars above the canyon street. And the con men con, but life goes on, for the city never sleeps. And to an old forgotten soldier, the dawn will come no more. For the old man has come home from the forest.
WIOX is supported by Kimchi Harvest at East Branch Farms on Route 30 at Briggs Road in Roxbury. Growers and sellers of authentic homemade Korean kimchi. The fermented superfood made from cabbage, radish, rhubarb, dandelions, sunchokes, and other seasonal plants and vegetables. And other mansions, traditional Korean side dishes. East Branch Farms. Information and ordering for pickup, 607-326-3000. 6177 or eastbranchfarms.com.
WIOX is supported by Pika Moose Restaurant on Route 28 in Big Indian, with farm-to-table cuisine for takeout Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Outdoor seating starts this Thursday. Menu updates and takeout orders at pikamoose.com or 844-254-6500. WIOX is supported by the Delaware County Chamber of Commerce, a catalyst for sustainability.